everybody. Welcome to Immanuel at Home. Another Sunday and yet another chance to meet together online. I'm really looking forward to our time together today. We've got a great morning planned. But just a reminder, in addition to making our morning service available on all the usual platforms, we are super excited to let you know that we are also streaming live via our Immanuel Facebook page at 9:30. So keep a lookout for that. Donna was telling us about a great scattered sermon story this week in our team meeting, and I just loved it. So I've asked him if I could share it with you this morning. Robs and Jono were on the bluff around lunchtime one day last week and decided they needed something to eat. So they saw a restaurant that was trying to make ends meet by selling takeaway coffees and toasted sandwiches and struck up a conversation with the guy behind the counter. Now, Jono really believes in starting up conversations and then trusting Holy Spirit will lead him in some way to speak truth and hope and love into the situation. So he asked the owner how business was going. And the guy shared how bad things were, that his business may even close, that some of his staff were unable to come to work as there wasn't enough work for them to do. The government had paid the relief, hadn't paid the relief salaries, monies owed to him. And as a result, the staff had begun to mistrust him. They started to think that he was maybe keeping it back as they had heard what the government promised on TV. And basically, he was going down quite a negative road. But Jono felt hope and faith rise up and encouraged him, saying that he would pray and really trust that the UIF would come in. The guy wasn't at all offended. And as Jono said, the temptation in these moments can be to empathize, but then to also go down the negative road about the government and South Africa and to partner with that kind of conversation. But that's not Christ in us. That's not what he's asked us to speak over and into people's lives. So Jono was in faith and spoke hope into his life. And when they went to pay, the guy said the cappuccinos were on him. How cool is that? Then Hess, one of the amazing administrators in our church office, shared an encouraging finance testimony. They're going through a tough time financially at the moment, so this was particularly meaningful. She said that it was with a bit of panic that she paid over 10% of her salary into the church account this month. It was 9:42 a.m. when she made the transfer. Then, at 9:44 a.m., a precious friend paid the same amount into her account out of the blue. The same amount about 2 minutes later. Just a quick debit credit transaction for God. Easy peasy, that's what he said to say. How great is that? Now, I emphatically believe the timing of that was not just a coincidence, but rather a God incidence. I feel God was letting her know that he had seen her generosity and faith, that nothing goes by unnoticed, and that he has her back. Just love it. Next up are the announcements. Someone who completed our church survey this week suggested that we move the announcements to before worship and the preach rather than in the middle of them. We heard you, thought it was a good idea, and decided to make the change. So sit back with a coffee in hand and check out what's happening in the life of Immanuel this week.
Sunday evenings no longer need to be spent on the couch. Come on and join us for a time of worship at our 5 p.m. meetings. We're also still broadcasting live via the iSOM Facebook page. Book early, because if you snooze, you lose. Our young adults are meeting at the church on Tuesday the 7th of July at 7 p.m. It's gonna be a cracker. All the young adults are welcome. Hey teens, please join us today on Zoom at 3 p.m. for a Connect sesh. The need to help families from Waterloo, Blackburn and Albert Park with food is an ongoing one. Please support our church MPO, Fingerprints of Love, again this week. If you'd like to partner with this initiative, see banking details on the screen. iSOM meetings back at church have been a blast. Please remember to book via WhatsApp. Bookings close on Monday evening. We're also still broadcasting live on the iSOM Facebook page, Wednesdays at 7 p.m. If you're struggling with any form of addiction or dependency, join our ACTS meetings every Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. at the Somerset Park Church building. Contact Kevin or Monique to book for the meeting. This coming week, our prayer meeting will be a little later. We're hoping this way more of you can make it. Join us this Thursday at 7:30 p.m. Please look out for the meeting link sent out via WhatsApp. If you're attending the Immanuel Somerset Park service, please place your tithes and offerings inside the box as you leave the auditorium. If you're at home or at the service today, you're also welcome to do an EFT or make a Zapper payment anytime during the week for your tithes and offerings. Thank you for your contributions.
I was listening to a podcast this week and heard this quote. We live in a time where there's lots of chaos and confusion, and where there is divine peace and wisdom. And the question was asked, what's pulling you? Friends, there is a pull on the earth right now, but which direction are you going in? Which direction am I going in? God is looking for people who will step in and stop the momentum of evil and chaos, who will step into a broken culture with divine peace and wisdom. Today, as we're about to enjoy a time of worship together, if you're feeling like you're being pulled in the direction of chaos and confusion, take a step back. Make a choice to quieten your heart and mind and intentionally choose to focus your attention on Him, who is the source of all divine peace and divine wisdom, and allow Him to minister truth and life and hope into your heart. And then look for an opportunity this week to pass that peace and wisdom forward. Our musos have chosen a great set list for this morning, so I encourage you to stand wherever you are and sing along with gusto. Remember, there is power in the words that we declare. Let's worship together.
My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. You call me citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healer. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. Cause when you call my name, so yeah. Out of the darkness into your holy state, you call my name. Out of that grave, into your holy
eternal life. Yes, it is, yeah. To you are we make. Let's sing this together, even when I don't see it. Come on, even when.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working.
Come on.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop. Above depression, his name is above loneliness. Oh, his name is above disease, his name is above cancer, his name is above every other name. He says, that is who. Shadows burn like a fire.
just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows. Shout Jesus from the mountains and Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name. I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Hi, everybody. My name's Greg, and it's my absolute pleasure and joy to be sharing this message with you today. A lot of people over these times have been facing great challenges around the topic of finances. And I want to talk into that today. But before we do that, let's pray together. Our God, we want to thank you that you are a good, good God who gives us unbelievable insights and ways in which to live life on planet Earth. And we want to learn from you, from your word, by your Holy Spirit, so that God, our souls would truly prosper, whether we have much or whether we have little. We pray for prospering souls. We pray today's message, Lord, wouldn't just be one of information, but God, that transformation would truly take place within our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. I've been going through a book titled Money and the Prosperous Soul by Stephen De Silva. He's a well-studied and qualified man from a financial background who, among other positions, also worked in a very well-known church administrating their finances. He shares some great Kingdom of God insights that he learned in his own personal journey that God took him on to bring him to a place of true financial freedom. And I'd like to share some thoughts that I gained from reading this book with all of us today. One such lesson he talks about in his book is when he and his family always seemed to just be barely making it each month financially. It didn't matter if he got a raise or he and his wife both got raises, if they got a promotion. Within a short space of time, they were once again touch and go on barely breaking even each month. After praying and asking God about this, God gave him a clear strategy to try out. God asked him to draw up a budget. Now, I know we don't all like budgets, but they can be super helpful. This budget would include saving and giving away. Whenever they got a promotion or increase, God said, don't automatically adjust your budget according to your new income. Because that's what most worldly people do. Don't just up your grocery spending because now you can afford to. Don't just trade in your car and get a better one, a newer one, because now you can. Ask God, your good Father, how you should budget your salary, your income. So they tried to keep a very similar standard of living within reason. And instead of upping the spend each month accordingly, they saved more and became more generous. It wasn't long, he says, just a few years of this practice, when suddenly they were truly living financially free. And don't forget, when we understand God's concept of generosity, he adds more than we can ever expect. That, of course, doesn't mean that we're never going to be tested or have hard times. But each time that they went through a hard time, they were better prepared to face the challenges that always come our way in this life, as Jesus said they would. Personally, I've started to live in a similar manner. And what a better way to live it is, compared to always adding expenses whenever you get more income. Saving and generosity together, not one or the other, are powerful ways of handling money. Now let's paint a picture that will help us understand, perhaps in a new light, what God expects from us with respect to our souls and the commodity called money that we handle. Imagine you're on a voyage. Imagine you're the captain of a cargo ship, responsible to deliver merchandise, placed in your capable hands by the rightful owners, and it's your job to navigate the ship safely and deliver the goods as a faithful steward. The owners have said the risks are great, but the rewards are going to be awesome. To whom much is entrusted, much is required. Be faithful with the little, and you will be entrusted with much, much more. Now, as your voyage begins, the first dangerous channel of islands you will have to navigate through is the archipelago called poverty. Lack and fear are its fellows. Loss and never enough are its anthem. Look sharp. They desire your cargo. They want what you're carrying, what you have been entrusted with. You will require faith and wisdom to successfully navigate them, but you can do it. Now, that's just the first set of dangerous waters to navigate. There still is another. Once you've gone through the archipelago of poverty, you will have to navigate the next archipelago called Mammon. Riches and greed are its fellows. Surprisingly, fear and never enough once again can be heard in their background anthem. They too want to lay a hold of your cargo. It's really not easy to get through them, but you can. Once again, faith and wisdom will be required. Once through these, your destination, destiny, awaits your arrival with rejoicing and great reward. Now, let's talk a little more about those dangerous archipelagos that you and I have to navigate through. Firstly, poverty and mammon are spiritual influences that we must all learn to resist. Poverty and mammon are not so much physical experiences, but are spiritually driven. They are unseen motivations of the soul that shape how we think and how we act. Often we can be unaware of the motivations of why we feel a certain way around finance or act or respond in a certain way. It's here that we should be sharp to the deception of mammon and poverty. It's like Each of these islands has its own current, pulling our cargo ship closer to their dangerous shores, pulling upon our misbeliefs and our fears like magnets. They are both radical opponents to wealth and a prosperous soul, which God wants us to enjoy. Let me reiterate here that wealth, well, let me say it another way. Having much and managing much is a great privilege not to be afraid of or frowned upon. And a prosperous soul is a most delightful experience. The goal is to enjoy a prosperous soul, whether you have much or little. Now, the two spirits of mammon and poverty should not become familiar spirits to us. They should not be our everyday cross to bear in this world. We should never get comfortable with either of them, as they are both enemy spirits to our destination, which God has called us to. They are outright enemies of a prosperous soul. Now let's take some time to break down this analogy a little bit more. The prosperous soul is the actual ship, and the level of prospering determines the size of the cargo we are able to successfully deliver. The more healthy our souls are, the greater the cargo we can be entrusted to deliver. This is a common teaching of our Lord Jesus, stewardship. Though each of us is entrusted with a different amount of cargo, our prosperous soul has a radical effect upon the path we travel, our delivery, and of course, our eventual rewards. Faith is vital in pleasing God, as the writer of Hebrews so clearly says. There are, however, some real misconceptions and confusions around faith. One such is how we handle the timing of seeing the promise or the breakthrough we are praying for, trusting God for. Our breakthrough doesn't always seem to come soon enough, does it? And how do we handle that space in between? We may feel that because God is a good father and I've asked for something good, and that because scripture says, when you ask, believe that you have received it and it will be yours, that we should have it now, immediately. After all, with God, all things are possible. But that immediate gratification is more a cultural narrative of current times, and certainly not something that throughout the ages was the common experience. We don't want to cook oats on a stovetop if it takes 20 minutes when you can buy instant oats, do we? We want microwave popcorn, even though it only takes 5 minutes on the stove. We want it and we want it now. We ask God and we want it now. And it seems to be the narrative of our times. Throughout the ages, the heroes of the faith were way more patient and kept on believing the promise was coming, no matter what the seeming delay was. Just take a good read of Hebrews chapter 11. Faith pleases God. Faith doesn't mean handling the tension. Sorry, faith means handling the tension of what's not yet seen with what we currently see. Faith requires us to live confidently between the problem and the promise, to live with a level of mystery as to why not yet, why the delay, without becoming exasperated. When I'm feeling somewhat concerned in my own life about the lack of breakthrough, I go to God, spending time, especially in the Psalms, hearing and looking for His voice to steady me and strengthen me. It's no one else's responsibility to strengthen myself in the Lord. It's primarily mine. Others may help, but I take responsibility for my walk with God. Let's talk a little bit more about receiving what we ask for in prayer. One danger for many of us is that we can sometimes vacillate between feelings of entitlement and feelings of unworthiness when it comes to receiving from God. They are opposite extremes of the spectrum, yet we can experience them both. Entitlement is horrible. I personally hate the arrogance of entitlement, don't you? Even when we as Christians can so easily meander into the field of entitlement, it's so surprising. We think, if God is my father and I'm his child, everything he has is mine. I have an inheritance. I should get what I ask for. He's a good God. The problem with this is there's very little humility. And humility enhances the flow of grace. As the humble receive grace upon grace and more grace, but the arrogant can miss out. Then on the other hand, our doubt about receiving from God can be rooted in a deep-seated underlying feeling of, why would God want to be so kind to me after the many mistakes I've made? It's basically a deep-seated low self-worth. And I justify not seeing God's goodness in my life because I feel unworthy. And here again, we don't understand grace. The powerful way to approach God and live is by faith, with a healthy understanding of my identity in Christ, as a beloved child of God now, fully able to ask and believe Him for anything good. But at the same time, my absolute reliance is upon His grace, His kindness and His love, not my position, demanding and entitling me as a spoiled brat might believe. I want it and I want it now. Just consider the attitude of Jesus, the one He had as He walked this earth with His Father God. Now back to stewarding money and resources. If you can believe it, money is actually a tool to reveal the issues of our souls. Money can press the buttons like few things else. Money is a meager treasure in the eyes of God, and not true riches. It's a tool God probably uses because we so readily place so much trust in it. Now, there is a classic parable in Luke 16 where Jesus teaches about a deceitful manager who uses his wisdom when he's caught out by his master to be merciful to his master's clients with his master's money, so that when he's fired, he has some allies who will remember him helping them out and return the favor. Simple sowing and reaping, that he was dishonest. But it's not the dishonesty that Jesus is commending, but the realization he has that amassing wealth in itself is not the pinnacle. Using wealth is more powerful and more beneficial, and that is rather what wealth, and it's rather what wealth can do for others where its power lies. It's how it can be used for building relationships and extending God's kingdom. Handle money for blessing's sake, not to amass it for one's own sake. I want to challenge us with that. Jesus somehow highlights this as a shrewd man, saying we ought to be wise with wealth and use it wisely, but then reveals to us the most powerful part of the parable, that money is not really true riches. How you handle money is the kindergarten, the basic training, a stepping stone to graduating into handling true riches. Yet, we daily see how many fall with the triviality of handling money. I want to close with this lesson from Luke 16. Jesus says the following, "One who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much. One who is dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much. If you then have not been faithful in the unrighteous wealth, mammon, who will entrust to you true riches?" If you've not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Those are incredible words that Jesus shares with us. You cannot serve both. You've got to choose one. And when you choose God, the calling of our heart is to have a prosperous soul, whether we have much or little. It is to desire to be blessed so that we can be a blessing to others. But what happens is the deception of money can become so important to us that it can trick us into actually moving away from our real destiny, the purposes of God for us in this world. We are blessed to be a blessing. God wants us to have a prosperous soul, every single one of us. How we handle money to Jesus is kindergarten. And I pray that from this, we will learn to handle money in a way that not only glorifies God and advances His kingdom, but becomes a joy and delight to ourselves, our families, and the people we know, because we are blessed to be a blessing. Choose today, friend, who you're going to serve, because you cannot serve both wealth or mammon and God. I would love us to make a declaration together now. So if you can, I'd love you to stand where you are, because I do believe there's power in declaring. And we're going to just say the following together. As you say it, my desire for all of us is that we will mix it with faith. We will say, God, this is where I want to go. This is the path that I want to walk. I want to walk to a place of being financially powerful and free, whether I have much or little. So let's stand together and let's do this. Are you ready? Join with me. I declare that God is my source and provider. I will seek first His kingdom in money matters. I will enjoy a prosperous soul because I am learning to steward worldly wealth better and better, and look forward to being entrusted by God with true riches even more. I am not a servant of money, but through my life, money will be a servant to enhance the advancement of Jesus' gospel and to bless others in and through my life. Amen. God bless you guys. It's been such a joy being with you. And I pray grace upon grace, so much of God's favor and His wisdom and faith in your life to navigate the different archipelagos as we go towards our destination. God bless you.